celebrating the sun, 36 half precious sisters that just love. Written to the Grand Master and again the Son of David, the servant of the Lord. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. There is no fear of God before his eyes, for he flatters himself in his own eyes, that his iniquity cannot be found out and hated. The words of his mouth are trouble and deceit. He has ceased to heart wisely and do good. He brought trouble well on his bed. He sets himself in a way that is not good. He does not reject evil. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast, you save all. How precious is your steadfast love. O God, the children of man can't take refuge in the shelter of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light. Oh, continue your steadfast love because we know you, and your righteousness to the upright of heart. Let not the foot of arrogance come upon me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evildoers lie fallen, they are thrust down, unable to rise. Lord, I thank you because of this day. I plead with you for mercy, for your grace. Reign over our lives. Come and be fully magnified. Because Lord, you are God. Thank you, Jesus. Because of your steadfast love. We welcome you, O Lord, unto our lives. Come and reign. Come and take over. And be fully in charge. In Jesus' name.
Thank you. Well, Jesus.
They will give you all their praise, all their glory, and all their honor. May your name be forever magnified. For you are forever holy. You are forever worthy. And your name is above every other name. Come and minister unto our lives. Minister unto our souls, O God. Come and bring the whole world for us. For Lord, you are God. In Jesus' name.
In chapter 5, we see
picture God's judgment to Belshazzar, where the Menetekel Barsini narrative comes in. That is, your kingdom has been divided to the Medians and Persians. That is kind of today Afghanistan and Iranians.
And chapter 6, you see God's deliverance of Daniel from the lion's den during the reign of Cyrus.
And when we go now to the second part, that is chapter 7 to 12, now we indulge into purely David's vision, I mean Daniel's visions. And you see vision of the four beasts and the establishment of God's kingdom. And these four beasts now come to be Babylon, Medo Persia. We talk of Medo Persia because it was a kingdom shared by two. And then we come to Greece or Greeks. And in this, the Greeks had four generals. We have the likes of Ptolemy, Seleucid, or Cilicia. And so number four is the Rome, which was the beast. And so chapter 7 is the vision of the four beasts and the establishment of God's kingdom. In chapter 8, when we come to that chapter, we will see the vision of Ram and the God. This God had two horns, and it was tilted. And number 3 is the vision of the 70 sevens in chapter 9. And the 70 sevens begins from the rebuilding of the temple. So we have from the times of the rebuilding of temple, that is verse 27 of chapter 9. So it talks of the rebuilding of the temple, 7 sevens, and then from them, 62 sevens, and then Messiah comes in, and Messiah is cut off, and then there is this, the last 7, which we are waiting for, but it isn't entitled to us, because that will be the 7 of the rapture. And so I'm doing these books so that, as we did the book of Revelation, so that you can understand and read on your own and equally understand, because very many people have different narratives, but I'm guiding you from pure Bible, deriving exactly what does the word talk about. And again, from chapter 10 to 12, we see the vision of the man and the future of God's people. And you will see the man's message to Daniel in chapter 10 verses 1 to chapter 11 verse 1. Again, you see the Near Eastern history from Daniel to Antiochus for Epiphanes. And for you to understand better this man Epiphanes, you need to read Maccabees, first and second Maccabees, which is a Deuteronomical book. But it explains very well. And we can't run away from that chapter, that book, because it is from that book where we get to understand the Asmonean reign or rule of the Maccabean kingdom after Seleucid of Cilicia, you know, defiled the temple the time he sacrificed a pig after being defeated by the Ptolemy who was in Egypt. And so when you learn much about the Ptolemy, the last Ptolemy was this lady called Egyptian lady who was also married to the Roman emperor. The lady was and so that is chapter 11 verse 2 to 20. And again you will see chapter 11 verses 21 to 35 talking about the rule of Antiochus for Epiphanes. And then chapter 11 verses 36 to chapter 12 verse 3, the rule of the king, and lastly the final message of Daniel, which is chapter 12 verse 4 to 13. Verse 4 begins with these things which you see, write them and seal them up. So what Daniel saw was not now left to the people to understand. He sealed the information. And we normally hand you it out that this is the same book that John the Beloved, John the Disciple, in chapter 4 and chapter 5, found in heaven of Revelation. But then what is the main picture? What is the big
a picture or the overall theme of this book. Because once you understand all these things, then when we begin reading or delving verse by verse, you will understand in a faster mode. What is the message that rings through every chapter? The message here is God is sovereign. He overrules and eventually will overcome human evil. God is sovereign. He overrules and eventually will overcome human evil. And so the narratives from chapters 1 to 6, we see the general rulers in these passages who are generally portrayed in a favorable light. Rulers not particularly opposed to the Jews. Rulers not out to get or persecute or destroy the Jews. But who are, in a way, trying to get favor, to gain favor from the Jews. And so, in general, God's people are able to get on with their lives. But then, times come when one or more of God's people threatened in some way. And that is when, if I would choose to jump to the book of Esther, when now many Koresh and Meruting are 50,000 of the Jews to rebuild the temple, Nehemiah the same, Ezra the same. Like if there are the remnants, when I'm all the same, we are going to Tabor here to Esther back. And that's when we come now to the lives of Mordecai, to the lives of Esther, to the lives of what access as three or as some races. That's when now we can change to the book of Esther. And to know that, yes, our problem is to the marriage. But then because of divine will of God, so that the Israelites are not annihilated by the king after the conviction by Haman, then God chooses Esther amongst 30 women. When the king was married to a lady called Vashti, and Vashti was so beautiful, the king had a feast for 180 days. Na akaleta sana siku moja. Na akaita mke wake kati ya wageni wote. Akawaambia, I want to show you how beautiful my wife is. Kwa hivyo, she ordered the wife to undress before everyone. And the queen could not accept. And that's how the divorce happened. She was removed out of the kingdom. And the king sent message to the dead kingdom that they should send their fair virgins so that out of them he can choose a wife from them. And out of the 30, only Esther got that chance. Why? Because of God's divine will. So times come when one or more of God's people threatened in some way. Not because they are being persecuted as Jews, but they are in trouble because they will not do what the emperor wants. And that's why, if you can check chapter 1, they are threatened. If a king finds you not fit in comparison to your fellows, because you did not heed to the rule that you heed the best that which belongs to the king, then what do you think will happen to me? In chapter 2, he threatens them, if you do not tell me the dream I had and hate the protection, then I will have a debate all of you, I will kill all of you. Because the king had a dream, and he forgot the dream. And it was because of God's grace. Because he's trying, God here is trying to show that your wise men, your witches, your sorcerers, your witch doctors are nothing compared to me and my servants. So here God is now beginning to discredit the kind of worship Babylonians had. And that is the same we find in chapter 3. If you don't bow down, then you'll be drawn unto the fiery furnace. But then God deals with these situations in a different way. Because God intervenes in the present historical circumstances by delivering his godly followers from danger. And he even uses the trouble to further their political careers. Because this is what happened, as we will find later. That immediately Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Mishael, Ananias, and Azariah were vindicated. As Nebuchadnezzar saw another person amidst them, the fourth person. And he says, he is like the Son of Man, the Son of God. These fellows, immediately after they came out, they were given a bigger position that they held, than they had before the throne. We see Daniel, after he was retrieved from the lion's den, he was given a very greater, bigger position. Actually, he became the third in command. So God can use something painful to you so that at the end of the day, you get what he has purposed you to get. So that at the end of the day, you become what he has purposed you to become. And so that's why we say that the passages in chapters 1 and 6 show God's people how to react when ruled by Gentiles. And when we talk of Gentiles, it's not you and me. When in the Old Testament, the Gentiles did not tend those people who worship in a pagan way, who don't acknowledge God, but they worship a multiple of gods. Gods of wood, we'll see that on the way. Gods of silver, gods of stone, gods of gold, gods of bronze. We'll see gods of wood and every other. Take an example of Joseph. Joseph's stories, how did Joseph behave in Egypt? How did he behave in Egypt? They are to be humble, respectful, hard-working men of integrity. And that is what we are called to become, to be respected, to be humble, to be reputable, hard-working men of integrity. And you see one way in which God helps his people when in difficult circumstances. He delivers them wonderfully. He delivered the three friends from the fiery furnace. He delivered Daniel. Imagine starving the lions. And then after starving them, you throw somebody there for the lions to eat, but they don't. And I need you to understand, if they had the lions, it meant that there are very many people who are executed through the lions. Hardly attempt. See what I have heard. It means that before the times of Daniel, many people had been mauled by the lions. The fact that they had the fire, that is the same thing. And if you read to the me, for example, the books of Jashar, well, you find its quotation in the book of Joshua chapter 10 verse 18. You find it in 2 Samuel chapter 1 verse 18. So you don't fear about reading the book of Joshua. You can get it in your heart. And so you hear that this is it not recorded in the books, in the book of Joshua. So in the book of Joshua, when you read it carefully, you come to understand how the Babylonians behaved during the time. Exactly this fiery furnace, which Nebuchadnezzar is using today, it is the same kind of judgment that Nimrod used to
to Abraham. When you read, reading from the book of Joshua. So you come to realize that this thing did not begin just the other day. It was their custom. And it was the same kind of punishment all over their kingdom. But then when we get into the second half of the book, because I'm saying half because that was 12 chapters, these become rather different. Even in this chapter 1 to 6, we see God vindicating them, God rewarding them with goodness, as in we see God's protection, we see God's deliverance. But then, chapter 7 to 12, we see a different kind of narrative. Because here, God's people are suffering terribly because they are God's people. They are suffering because wicked men hate God and his people. Because wicked men, it's like they are in rivalry between God and God's people. But how does God deliver his people from oppression and persecution in these 12 chapters, 6 other chapters? Actually, in these chapters, he often does not deliver them. They suffer terribly year after year. Because it is from these chapters that now, because of this suffering, Daniel will humble himself. And you see from chapter 9, he starts to question himself. Why are we suffering? It means that we are suffering so that we can now think of going back. Yaani kama tunapitia mateso ili tuweze kujirudi tujue ni kwa nini tunapitia mateso. Kumbe kwa sababu the other time God was delivering them so that he can, because the time they were supposed to be in Babylon was 7 years. Written in the books, in the book of Jeremiah chapters 25, 26, 27, 28, and 29, you find it is recorded that my people will stay in Babylon for 70 good years. And then Daniel starts to wonder, we are praying, but we are not getting answered. And our prayers are not vindicated, are not answered. Why? Maybe it is like to tell us that this is no longer our home. Yes, before Jeremiah had given us a word, and he is saying that now settle down, build your houses, look for a house, give your girls and sons for marriage. But now it seems different. So what is happening? And then Daniel humbles himself, he goes up to one fasting, and that's what we see now in chapter 10. And we see the angel of God was bound by the passion to wings for 21 days. And he comes to tell him from verses 4 to 14, immediately we began prayer, God gave me a word to bring to you an answer to your prayer, but the prince of Persia could not allow me. How many times you prayed and you failed to get an answer because you stopped praying because you did not get an answer? Kumbe ilikuwa imefuta inafanya pale juu na malaika akakosa kupita kwa sababu ulisimamisha maombi hauendeleza maombi. So that will also come and revisit that. Deliverance in these chapters then is more a distant future hope than present reality. Lots of suffering to endure, Israel overrun, saints suffer terribly, and many get slaughtered. God seems to be doing nothing. God simply allows it to happen, but with a reason. I want you to know that God is sovereign. He is working out his purposes. And no matter how bleak things look, no matter how bleak things look into your life, no matter how many times you pray that you've not gotten an answer, I need you to realize and to understand that God is sovereign. No matter how much people of God called upon to suffer eventually, one day God's kingdom will come. And his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So today, we find the same thing. Sometimes we experience wonderful deliverance by God. Sometimes the suffering, the agony, remains year after year.
But we experience wonderful strengthening from God to survive. But I pray that you don't need to be strengthened so that you survive, but instead that you be fully redeemed, fully delivered. Today we find the same thing. Sometimes we experience wonderful deliverance by God. Sometimes the suffering, the agony, remains year after year. But we experience wonderful strengthening from God to each other. That's why I'm saying that you don't need to endure. You need to be delivered. God is all wise. And the reason I'm saying that you don't need now to suffer to endure is because Jesus is today alive. He came to redeem you and me. And for that fact, you need to understand that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And then indeed the Holy Spirit fills you, you must be made a new thing altogether. So God knows what is the right thing, when to remove the suffering and when to allow it to continue, so that we experience that truth. For he says in chapter 12 of 2 Corinthians, verse 7, my grace is sufficient to you. And so, in Daniel chapter 2, he had a vision, and he saw a statue. The head was of gold, the chest of silver, the belly and the waist of bronze, the legs of iron feet, the legs of iron and feet of iron and clay. So the head was of gold, chest and arms of silver, belly and thighs bronze, legs of iron, feet of iron and clay, and stone that becomes a great mountain. And again in Daniel 7, he sees the visions of beasts, lion with eagle wings. He sees another animal which is like a bear. He sees leopard with four wings and four heads, a terrible monster with 10 horns and a little horn, which was shouting, you know, words of blasphemy. And again, Messiah descends to receive the kingdom. And Daniel 8, he sees round with two horns and now God with a great horn, four horns plus a little horn. And so this head is now Babylon. Middle Persia is the chest and arms of silver. Greece is the belly and thighs of bronze. And it is very interesting, then, if we are to talk about Greece. This young man, Alexander the Great, was of 16 years when he began ruling. And he arranged the army. It was immediately after his father died. And he chose to conquer the Persians. And so he began his journey all the way to near India, all the way to Egypt. He spent like a year in Egypt. He built a city called Alexandria, and everywhere he went, he married. And upon marrying, getting a child, naming the child if it's a boy, after himself. And then he went all the way to Babylon, and it is there, when he was 21 years, that he was poisoned and died aged 21 days. When he was in his bed, the deathbed, the emperors asked him, the generals asked him, who will rule after you if you die? And he told them that whoever is powerful will rule. Because he had more than one general. The strongest was the Ptolemy and Seleucid. Praise God. And so the legs of iron, feet of iron, a
and claim is wrong. And so when you talk of the feet, that is the legs, and you know, that's when we come to the Eastern Rome and Western Rome. And that is when now the kingdom of Rome got divided into two during the reign of Constantine. And he had two palaces, one in the Vatican and the other one in Constantinople, which is in current day Turkey. And so the Bishop of Rome was now in charge of the Western Rome, and Constantine was in charge of the Eastern Rome, which was in Constantinople. And lastly is the Kingdom of God. And so in this book, it is a book full of lessons, so many to learn from reading. Not just a fascinating book with wonderful stories, but this is a book with lots of good preaching material here, lots of good theology here, not just about God and His sovereignty, salvation and judgment, but also about man and his pride and arrogance and his response to God. Lots of good pastoral theology. An example is Nebuchadnezzar's spiritual journey. Where does Nebuchadnezzar stand spiritually at the beginning of chapter 2? When he had this dream. Where he is different to where he is at the end of that chapter. We see King was impressed by Daniel because he can tell what the dream actually was, even without being told the kind of the dream. And then it's interpretation. And it is from here that we find that Nebuchadnezzar realizes that Daniel's God is greater than his own God. That Daniel has access to a power that is greater than the power he has. And so Nebuchadnezzar worships Daniel, which is very funny, if I may read you chapter 2, verse 46, for you to get. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel, and he paid him honor and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. So you need to understand now the kind of understanding this man has. He thinks then, because Daniel could unveil this, Daniel is God. He does not worship Daniel's God. He wants people now to worship Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar then, this is to tell you that he is still basically man-centered and sees God as a very powerful houseboy. Someone who is there to do man's bidding. And so Nebuchadnezzar, no doubt, thinks it would be great to have Daniel and friends around him. And because of that, then he appoints him big positions, because he sees with this man how close I am. And this is whereby many people are brainwashed and misused. Because to Nebuchadnezzar, having Daniel around will make his kingdom grow. Not having the God of Daniel present. And so to him, having Daniel and his friends around, great to have their spiritual power present, and so to speak, harnessed for the good of the empire. Great to have their God on his side, but he is not ready to worship their God. And that's why we conclude that Nebuchadnezzar was not truly converted. What sort of signs would show he is truly converted? As you read this book, that is what are signs of true regeneration and new birth. If truly converted, Nebuchadnezzar would have humbled himself before the true God, would be asking, what can I do so that this God is pleased with me? But we don't see him asking these questions. Nebuchadnezzar, not doing anything like that, he orders people to give sacrifice before now his new gotten God, Daniel. Impressed with that, Daniel is God. Knows that Daniel's God really can reveal mysteries and communicate with men. And that is the very many mistakes people do. When we, servants of God, deliver, they start seeing us instead of seeing God. And nothing should make you see servants of God as God. Always see them as just instruments. See them as instruments, and that will be good. But after a while, Nebuchadnezzar forgets the message that Daniel brought him, forgets or refuses to believe that his kingdom will one day perish. Because he forgot very quickly that he was told that after the kingdom of gold, then that kingdom will be defeated by the kingdom which will come after that kingdom. This kingdom will not be as strong as the other. We can see this in what he built next. And he meant that is indeed all of gold. So what is Nebuchadnezzar saying here? He is seeing an image which is of gold. What had God said to Nebuchadnezzar through the dream of the stone, of the statues of? That his kingdom represented by gold in the end would pass away. Even the kingdom of silver, represented by silver, will also pass away. All the kingdoms, so to speak, will pass away because the stone will shatter that and then a big mountain will grow. The rest of the statue was made of all materials representing other kingdoms. But Nebuchadnezzar refuses to accept that. He now builds an image in chapter 3, which is all golden. He is saying the golden kingdom will be the only kingdom. He is saying my kingdom will be the only kingdom. My kingdom will never pass away. Perhaps he is even saying, I, Nebuchadnezzar, will never pass away. And that's how many people also distort their harmony by being, you know, corrupted by any material gain, any power presented before them. So Nebuchadnezzar's mind once again set on making his empire everlasting, even though he has been told by God that it will not last forever. This image of all gold remains actually shows his continued rebellion against God. But I need to see another aspect here. The supreme God, the sovereign God, comes to this man, and because they don't know each other, he doesn't sit down and pray to his God so that God can communicate to him. Because there are his children present, God comes to tell him now, you brought my children here. Because of their presence here, this kingdom and all the others which will come and purport sovereignty over my children, they will all go. So God will speak to everybody, regardless of what matter they are in. And so, Nebuchadnezzar makes an image of a man. Why did he make an image of a man, not of an animal? Because he demands everyone must worship it. And I need you to notice here that he does not say worship this wherever you like, whenever you like, or worship this 3 times a day. 4 times a day at certain set times. But whenever the music plays, whatever you are doing, you have to stop and bow down to this image. I love this Chelimoyo SDA Church choir song. Bow. Come now, Adura. The one who gave Babylon its greatness, the emperor.
Nebuchadnezzar, the greatest man, the superman, the divine man, the man who was worthy to be worshipped as a god. And I need you to see, because of those mischiefs, there is no way his kingdom was to reign. When people bowed down to this statue, saying, Nebuchadnezzar, you are more important to me than anything else in the world. I serve you, fear you, trust in you. Is that not blasphemy? This is the same thing which is continuing every day and day. And so, because my outline is very much huge, I don't know whether I will do it today or not. This still happens today. Go to North Korea. You find Kim Il-sung, who is the father to the current king today. Listen to what a commission on international religious freedom had to say in 2005 about life in North Korea today. Thank you. Father Kim Il-sung is the first phrase Northern Korean parents are instructed to teach to their children. From counter to grave, North Korean citizens are surrounded by the all-encompassing presence of the great leader and his son, the dear leader, Kim Jong-un. The Kim dynasty is much more than an authoritarian government. It also holds itself out as the ultimate source of power. Virtue, spiritual wisdom, and truth for the North Korean people. It is now known that every home in the country has a portrait of the great leader Kim Il-sung and the dear leader Kim Jong-un. Inspectors visit homes to hunt out fines and admonishments if the portraits are not well kept. Every government building and subway car displays the two portraits, and every adult citizen wears a button of Kim Il-sung. Movies and propaganda constantly repeat the blessings bestowed on them by the two kings. Now I want you to see how the world keeps going down, 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 away from where the Lord led it. Kim Il-sung himself died in 1994, but his son Kim Jong-un continued the idea that his father should be worshipped. And he expects to be worshipped alongside his father. North Korea is an atheistic state. It doesn't need any other gods, because the state itself is God. And the state is headed up by the divine dynasty of the kings. The way the king dynasty is worshipped in North Korea is about the best commentary you can find on these chapters of Daniel, from chapters 1 to 12. Everything you see here is reproduced in that situation. In that situation in the world today. The state that claims other gods. Go to the Western countries. After every village there is a cathedral. But those are today museums. They are of no use. And I tell you the truth. In a few years to come, if something will not be or will not have been done, even Africa, you run into apostasy. Because in 10 to 15 years, you are not hearing the evil lesbians, lesbians, and all of you, and artists. Kenya today has the Artists Association of Kenya. So this is to tell you that they are coming slowly, not forgetting that the many Christians we have today are just but statues, Christians by names. And so this is the main reason which has driven me to decide to teach you, to enable you to understand this chapter, this book. And I need you to notice that I'm not preaching. I will be slowly teaching, because I need you to understand it fully so that you can put it into practice. Well, I know I'm not that of a good teacher, but I know even if I'm that preacher, because I'm a proclaimer, that I will try. You need to understand these things. Praise the name of the living God. Because we see a state that claims to meet all the needs of its members, both physical, spiritual, emotional. You don't need another God. That's what they are promoting today. You've got the status of to father you. A megalomaniac human ruler who's worshipped and who's worshipped as a divine servant, persecution against anyone who refuses to give the state and its ruler that rule. And that's one. And so Nebuchadnezzar, despite what God has shown him, told him what he had told him about the future in the dream of chapter 2, he's still determined to carry on with his God. And you come to realize that only Cyrus who obeyed God. Because it is Cyrus, God came and gave him a vision. What you find in Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. And he gave an order that they should go and renew the temple. And that's why we talk of since the beauty of the temple. So this guy did not honor God. He did not allow God's goal to make him a God descent. But he wants to make him, but he wants to carry on with his goal to make Babylon eternal. And because the three friends of Daniel will not worship the statue to the fiery furnace, they must go. And they are not miraculously preserved, saved from death. Once again, Nebuchadnezzar confronted by the power of the true God. In chapter 4, he gets the heart of an animal. And again, how does he respond? He talks about the wonderful power of the three gods. And holds that no one should speak against his God. But Nebuchadnezzar still shows no sign of repentance. There is no asking for forgiveness, no let me serve him. And this is the same thing we go through, my brothers and sisters. Maybe the sufferings you are going through are pushing you to the corner so that you can turn to God. So that you can think of turning your life to God. This is the same thing people are doing today. And so today, I won't go further from there because this is not something we are doing in a hurry. Amen? I need you to understand bit by bit. I'm just doing an overview. And by the time we start doing the chapter by chapter, then you will have to get with you. Praise God. Reason I'm doing this, I need you now to see and get yourself where you are. I request you to go and read these chapters 1 to 12, so that when you are going through them, you have an idea. I've read these chapters not once. Read them, understand them, and then you'll be in a position to understand everything else. Now I'll be delving into you. Lord, I thank you because of these children. I surrender them to you, O God. You are ever faithful and loving God. I pray for deliverance. Don't abandon these children from nowhere. Be with them. Guide them. Show them your mercy. Show them your love. Enable them, O God, because, O God, you are God. How I pray that, Lord, you minister your love to them. That, O God, you minister your healing to them. That you minister your deliverance to them. Deliver them from every problem they are in, be it attacks, be it suffering, be it fear, be it worry, be it doubt, be it sickness, be it poverty. Lord, I destroy every sickness, every attack, every scheme of the devil, and I plead with you for mercy. I pray that God you set these your children free. Minister your love to them. Minister your love to them. I pray that you meet with each and every one of these your children at their most point of need. Set them free, Lord. Lord, we echo your words. You say we come to you with all the languages, the burdens, and you will set us free. I pray these your children are before you.
that you want to set them free. Redeem them to yourself and enable them forever. I pray that you fill them with your spirit. Spirit of wisdom and that of understanding. Spirit of counsel and mind. Spirit of knowledge and the spirit of the fear of the Lord. And Lord, they will be the best. Spirit of grace and faith and of your revelation, it is still unto us, Lord. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace forever. In Jesus' name. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.